recording, please? Should you want to? Apologies. We have apologies from Councillor Steph O'Keefe, Barrington, Preston and Rennie. Are there any other apologies anybody would like to identify? If not, that's the list. Are there any declarations of interest, either people declared or want to declare now? Thank you. There's no matters of urgency and there's nothing on this agenda other than consent and check. We move to the agenda. Minutes of the previous meeting are pages 5 to 18. Anything on there? So we move into service delivery plan, but just before we start the meat of the agenda today, I would just like to say that we're going to be discussing some things, the like of which we've never discussed before. This is a very, very good day for us to be to be politicians in Merseyside. It's a very easy job. Being a councillor is not an easy job, but it's easy for our conscience. Because we're presented here with the evidence now that we are the best fire authority in the country. Okay, there's still some to be assessed, and I'm sure there's an opportunity for them to achieve our level, but we would think, and I think we're entitled to make that, or jump to that conclusion, that the decisions that we've made over the years, that the leadership of our officers, that the diligent, hard work of all of our staff at all levels has led us to where we are today. And on behalf of the members of the authority, the present members, but also those from the past who have contributed to where we are today, I want to thank the people of Merseyside who have given us the support and the ability to get here. Our staff, all of our staff, we are so lucky with the staff that we have for giving us the results, the service delivery plan, the inspection report, and as it flows from that, our considerations of the changed IMP are all parts together of a success story in Merseyside, and for which we are very, very grateful. And if colleagues, those who are present, would take that message back to their colleagues. We really are very, very grateful for all the support that we've had over the years. So we move on to service delivery plan, and Jackie Sutton is going to just talk us through that.
Just before Jack starts, I just introduce the person of course is a request that members scrutinise performance against the objectives of our performance and outcome targets as set in the service delivery plan. 2018-19, and this actual report covers the whole period from April 2018 to March 2019, and the recommendation that members approve the attached report by its publication on our website.
Good afternoon, I'm Jackie Sutton, and I'm the Integrated Risk Management Plan Officer. As the Chief said, I'm going to cover the whole period from April 2018 to the 31st of March 2019. Although this is recorded as November to March, but I'm actually going to cover the whole year because it's cumulative 3 years. So one of your packs has functional plan updates in it. Before the end of the year, it was decided to introduce a RAG, red, amber, the green, coding for the action plans to tell you where they're actually up to. So the key is if something is green, the action is now business as usual or absolutely complete. Amber, it's well underway, completion is anticipated by a stated date, and red is the action is on hold or not started yet. There are action points within each action, and some of them will carry forward in some way or another into this year's functional plans. But many are now complete and business as usual, such as the missing persons workstream ops response had, the launch of national operation learning, and electronic recording of breathing apparatus and PPE tests. Now looking at the key performance indicators for the whole period. So this end column here, the red and the green, is how we've actually performed over the year 18-19. The There was extremely hot weather in June and July, as I've told you repeatedly, and this had a massive impact on some instrument types. But since July, the weather has been cooler and wet, and performance has fallen back to normal levels. So we'll actually go into a bit more detail with each of these now. So first of all, we'll look at where we have achieved targets. So primary fires, there were 241 less primary fires in 1819 compared to 1718. This type of performance indicator was less affected by the hot weather, but June was over target, and we've looked into it, and there was an increase in accident dwelling fires, obviously because of the hot weather, and vehicle fires, which contributed to this increase, but since June it's fallen back to normal levels again. False alarms attended, there were 192 less than the previous year, 1718. And the attendance standard to have our first appliance at all life risk incidents within 10 minutes was achieved 93.9% of occasions, the target is 90%. Sickness absence, both grey book, which is operational staff, and green book, which is non-uniform staff, achieved a target of less than 4% shifts lost to sickness absence. And overall, we performed 3.41% for the whole. We're just looking now at accidental dwelling fires and indicators that fall out of that. So there were 113 to target, and performance was fairly consistent with last year. The only month this year that the target was exceeded was June with 96 incidents, but on all other months the target was achieved. Sadly, there were 4 fatalities in accidental dwelling fires this year. Their age ranges from 43 to 87, 2 males and 2 females, 2 of them were in one incident. This, however, is the same number as last year. We had 4 last year, and it's the lowest number since records were started. All 4 of the fatalities were in areas considered to be high deprivation. Prevention work played a massive part of the reduction in the fatalities, and HMI did praise this area of our work. Of the 82 injuries and accidental dwelling fires, 13 and 12 incidents were recorded as serious, meaning the majority was minor, such as preliminary checks for smoke inhalation. Some more LPRs where we achieved our target. Deliberate fires in non-domestic premises have fallen this year, following a peak when we saw 11 incidents in July. 43 of the 73 incidents were in Crown properties, prisons. Prison incidents did fall throughout the year because we worked quite closely with the prisons. However, we did notice in May of this year, which obviously I'm not reporting on at the moment, there were 6 incidents, so we will keep an eye on that to make sure it's not going back up again. Deliberate vehicle fires attended, there were 38 less than last year, and this is achieved by our close working with PARs. Deliberate antisocial behaviour, small fires, again fairly consistent with last year's figures. With a peak in June of 580 incidents, in July with 906, again related to the weather. Our usual average is around 270 a month, so 906 is a lot. These are key performance indicators where we're within 10% of target. So they're all kind of related, number of incidents, number of fires, secondary fires, and they were all affected by the hot weather. From the 23rd of June to the 15th of July, we saw 127 incidents of incident kill, in addition to large-scale incidents of Formby Pine Woods and a waste treatment centre during that period. Other large incidents over the year, and by large I mean where we had 20 or more assets there, that includes offices and appliances, were Greenway Environmental in Kirkdale, a canal collapse in Melling, Littlewoods on Edge Lane, and the eco-recycling plant in Birkenhead. They were some of the big incidents we attended. Total fires, there were 1,457 incidents in July compared to 740 in the previous July, so again an indication of how busy it actually were. And secondary fires, there were 459 more than in 1718 in the total year. Carbon output of buildings is CO2 per metre per building. There's a slight increase this year. There was an increase in water usage, which is thought to be down to the train school, but it's not a huge increase. And these KPIs where we've not achieved our target this year. So the total number of emergency calls received, there were 4,250. 35 more emergency calls received this year than in 2017-18. And in July, there were 6,076 compared to 2,192 in November, which is our usual busy time, so you can see that they were very busy. Total special service calls, crews attended 3,242 special services, which was 118 more than last year. There's no one particular type of incident causing this increase. And while we are showing over target, and I've mentioned to those of you who've been on authority before, there's been much discussion around special services because some of them we don't want to discourage and some of them we can't influence. So for 1920, it's been decided there won't be a target, it'll be quality assurance only. And we've also introduced a new indicator, water rescues, and we also have RTCs, which are included in this figure, because we feel we could possibly have an influence over them. So we've introduced that separate indicators as well. Road traffic collisions were 61 over target, and 62 more than last year, and all districts were over target for the year. Injuries in RTC. They were higher than last year, and 53 of the 325 injuries were considered serious. Sadly, there were also 12 fatalities in RTCs. MFRS only attend about a fifth of RTCs in Merseyside, and our partners at Merseyside Police use data which records killed and seriously injured. This data illustrates the bigger picture, which we don't see because we're appropriate to the ones we're requested to attend, and shows actually a decreasing trend for injuries and fatalities in RTCs. Home fire safety checks. Operational crews delivered 40,082. In June and July, because of the fake conditions, all HFSC activity was suspended because it was fire fields only, basically. So the crews have worked really hard to meet to get to that, and they're actually only 10 under their targets. So, 53% of HFSCs delivered were identified from a status report, which identify a household where one member of the family is over 65. There were 8,184 safe and well visits delivered by prevention advocates. And in total, operational crews, prevention officers and volunteers have delivered 49,851 fire safety checks in 18-19.
Thank you. Right. It's very important that we as members take on board. We have responsibility to the scrutiny to these.
Thanks for that, it was really interesting. That was my first one, very useful. I just wanted to ask in terms of how does it compare to kind of other similar fire service areas in terms of what's the context, so have the same kind of peaks and troughs that we've seen, do they have similar levels of safety rate, things like that, for example?
We do benchmark ourselves against other metropolitan fire rescue services and nationally in relation to things like sickness absence and so on. So if we pick sickness absence in the first instance, I think Merseyside, on those recent figures, is in the top five of in the country in regards to levels of performance. About to kind of quantify that and assure you absolutely what we are at the top end of the highest performing fire rescue services. And down to a lot of the work that we put in and the support that we provide staff that's coming off and moving away from probably more draconian measures about getting people into work, but being really supportive around the capability and support plans to bring people back into the workplace, which has been really successful. talk about even some of the poorer performing aids where we've shown as red. Actually, every fighter she serves in the country will be showing as red for the number of calls it receives. Every fighter she serves in the country will be showing as red for the number of small fires that were attended, because it was a very, very hot sort of period. We moved into spate conditions, as did all the fighters and services across the UK, and we went to a significantly higher number of calls than we've ever gone to. Genuinely, that's the busiest sort of period that I can remember in my 30 years we have from Merseyside Fighters and Services. So when that happens, the number of calls that we've received is skewed, and so on and so forth. The number of total fires is skewed, but the fact of the matter is we will be reflective of what's happened up and down the country. Speed of attendance, if you look at the percentage of times we get there with our response standard of 93.5%, I think it was, that's the top end of performance across the UK fire rescue service. If you look at actually our average response time, so currently 5:42 across the whole of Merseyside, that is fifth, sixth fastest in the whole UK fire rescue service. So we are responding rapidly to those incidents. So as kind of a rudimentary benchmark against other services, we are a high performing fire rescue service in comparison. Some of those are the decisions that the authority have made in relation to professional whole time firefighters. As I said previously, it allows us to do a significant number of home fire safety checks because we are productive in that time that's spent waiting for calls to come in. We're not just sat on a fire station waiting for the call to be received. We are doing things in the community which helps protect the community. That's evidenced in the next report, which helps identify that area as outstanding. So, not only are we quick and rapid, but also effective in the service of that we're delivering to the public.
We meet regularly with the other North West fire services, and I mean, without any disrespect to them, we are head and shoulders above. But that, again, it's a decision that was made years ago to retain full-time firefighters, and that method of firefighting. I think on most benchmarks, we'll be in the top cadre of firefighters in the whole country. Yes.
Thank you. Thank RTCs generally are less numbers. Do you have any ideas why that number is going down?
I think Ben just was chatting with me earlier.
Yeah, do you want me to answer that?
Let me just go back. What the police use is that's 19 data stable for every road traffic collision, or they are aware of every road traffic collision being decided. We are only going to calls where we are required to either assist in the extrication of an individual, so one off the job, or serious of road traffic collisions. But the thing to point out in regards to those statistics, that's what we go to. It's not necessarily what we prevent. Some of the educational work that the team do is focused on young people predominantly, aged 16 to 25, because we recognise that they are a particularly vulnerable group in relation to just passing driving tests and driving at speed, being distracted through a whole multitude of other factors which cause them to be a little bit more vulnerable than most. And that's where we're targeted on educational input. So when the inspectors came to look at the work that we do, we do focus on road traffic collisions, but we were able to drill down to our performance in relation to that specific age group. And then we'll compare with what we'll say now. The number of kills and serious injuries has significantly diminished across that particular group. And that is attributable to the whole partnership, but we're complemented by the work that we do in our communities, particularly focused on that age group and that category. Some of the other pedestrians will be included in there. We have less of an impact on educating all the people who step off the pavements and by a car. We do some work with them, but our work is focused particularly educationally around those 16 to 25 year old individuals.
Brilliant, thank you.
Okay. Any other questions, colleagues? Thank you. Well, as I say, these are. It's always this. Zero fire deaths would be our objective. When there are some people dying in fires and other incidents, then we've still got work to do. But our objective, politically, is to maintain Merseyside as one of the safest, if not the safest, part of the country from a fire point of view. And I think the statistics here again today help us with that argument. Anything else? Right. We'll move on to agenda item 4, which is HMICFRS inspection report. Chief.
Thanks, Chair. We pick up from the comments previously around the levels of performance from the scouts and the information that Jackie has presented. Members will be aware the inspectors came into Merseyside back in December and spent a week or so with us looking at all aspects of the work that we do, efficiency and effectiveness, and around key pillars that they feel are good benchmarks against how effective the fire rescue services are delivered to the public. In effect, what their role is to act as the public and to scrutinise the decisions that officers and the authority have made in the deployment of our resources to ensure that we are equipping ourselves and delivering the best possible outcomes. As a result of that, I'll summarise in the comments that have been made by the inspectors. I'm happy to pick up on a little bit more detail. But they provided an overall summary in relation to their report, and rather than we go into detail, I'll read it verbatim. As we are very pleased with the performance of Merseyside Fire and Rescue Service in keeping people safe and secure, and in particular with its effectiveness. We found it to be outstanding at preventing fires over risks and responding to national risks. Highlight the fact that members that we are the only fire and rescue service of the first 30 fire and rescue service which have been identified as outstanding in two categories. And that's testament to the hard work and endeavours of staff. Merseyside is good at understanding the risk of fire and emergencies, protecting the public through regulation and responding to fires and other emergencies. It's good at providing an efficient service, and it's good at utilising its resources and making the service affordable now and in the future. And the service is good at looking after the people. We judge it good at promoting the right values and culture, getting the right people with the right skills, and managing performance and developing leaders. Their main categories, and of those three pillars as they describe them, we are one of only five rescue services to be pulled across those three pillars, notwithstanding the comments that were made about being outstanding in a couple of those areas. Goes on then to say, but we judge that it requires improvement in ensuring fairness and promoting diversity. I'll come back to that in a second. I said overall, we commend Merseyside Fire and Rescue Service for its performance, and we are confident it's well equipped for this to continue. So, really positive report, celebrated by staff and communities alike, and certainly celebrated from some of the partners who've been involved in the delivery of our services in conjunction with us over a period of years. This is the first time Merseyside Fire and Rescue Service has been inspected by Her Majesty's Inspectorate for over 10 years. Prior to that, we would do what was described as a peer review process, so other services would come in and support us in our improvement. This inspection regime has significantly more teeth than that. It's not an easy ride. It's not someone who's coming in to counter support. It's coming in to counter critique the fire risk service. Is it using its resources efficiently, effectively, and is it delivering positive outcomes for the public of Merseyside? I think categorically that's been reinforced in the comments that the Chair's made, but also the feedback from the report. And nationally, we've already had a significant number of fire and rescue services who've started to approach us about how we can assist them in developing and enhancing their work, particularly around preventing fire decay and responding to national risks. And members will also be aware that Merseyside Fire and Rescue Service is the lead authority for national resilience. So, in the nice pathway, it's no surprise that we are strong in that category, but equally we are there and able to support other services. If I draw them down into, because I am a little bit like this, into the area where we were described as requires improvement, and particularly focused on ensuring fairness and promoting diversity. And I take that, and I take the fact that our firefighters don't represent the communities we serve at this moment in time. But I would draw members' attention to a couple of pieces in the national report itself, as well as the Merseyside one. So, in the Merseyside report, it describes the makeup of firefighters in Merseyside, the diversity of the group. The national report then highlights, again, similar issues in respect of for what the other 16 fire rescue services that were inspected at that part. So the draw members' attention to page 161 of the report. This is not done in defence, it's just reporting out the accuracies of the information. Page 161 of the national report, which covers off the second tranche of inspections, highlights the percentage of firefighters which are female across the whole of the tranche. When you look at the performance of Merseyside in comparison with all the fire and rescue services in that tranche, the other 16, Merseyside are the highest performing in relation to the diversity, the percentage of female firefighters. Again, it should be celebrated, and I think it will, rather than necessarily not. We know there's some more work to do. We can talk previously about ensuring our female firefighters are able to progress through the organisation, but there's a direct comparative with other services, and certainly even in tranche 2, we are high performing. If I then ask you to turn over the page onto page 161, it starts to detail the percentage of BAME firefighters, Black Asian minority ethnic firefighters, who are employed by Merseyside Fire and Rescue Service. And again, it compares and contrasts us with other tranche 2 comparators. What this graph says, and maybe it's not exactly easy to read, what it says is the lighter green colour, as you look at it, is the percentage of BAME firefighters employed. Darker green colour relates to the population of Merseyside or those other services. So if you look at the fact that Merseyside has a percentage of about 5.5 populace who are BAME, and actually the number of firefighters employed by Merseyside now is 4.9%. So we are very close to being reflective of the communities that we serve, particularly around ethnic groups. So again, just highlighting that point on the basis of the report and its overall findings and the summary of that report. Trust me, that doesn't mean that we have rest on our laurels around some of those things. There's still some work to be done. And we know, and I've said to members before, particularly members who are more established, I still believe there's some work that we can do around the kind of culture of the organisation and ensuring that we are moving forward and we are delivering the best possible outcomes for the public. But we're also creating an environment in the workplace which is really conducive to good relations. I'm probably happy to pause at that point, Chair. I'm happy to take any questions around the specifics of the report.
Thank you, Chair. I was actually going to make a similar point to Phil about the diversity figures. Just another point that looks a little bit off on page 79 in terms of the number of firefighters per thousand. I'm assuming the figures they're using are total numbers rather than full-time equivalents.
So just ask a question for
70, page 79,
yeah.
Under workforce, number of firefighters per thousand, and it's 0.5, whereas the English average is 0.6.
That, yeah, it will relate to, we all employ firefighters in different ways, in the nicest possible way. So, dependent on whether those firefighters are employed under the same contracts, community the same contracts, or they employ as all time firefighters, will be a determining factor on this. What I would say is, even the HMI is still working through the kind of best way to benchmark services in respect of the figures that they've produced. And I'll give you an example which is related to BAME firefighters particularly, because they're benchmarking us against the population, so at 5.5%, but actually the better determinant would be working population or working age population would give you a better indication of better reflective of what could be achieved by the service. But my understanding is that is a number of that's a firefighter per thousand population, irrespective of how that firefighter is designated, whether they be detained or whether they be held as a firefighter.
I think that's the problem, though, because the way this is presented, particularly with the line above, with the cost per firefighter, anyone just looking at the headline figures would think they're getting very poor value for money on Merseyside. So I think that point really needs to be made, particularly in terms of future reports.
I read that, and I think what you need to do, we know this, but we stand in about the middle of metropolitan authorities. But when you compare us with all authorities, then we're slightly more expensive, but so are all the metropolitan authorities. And then I thought that if you look at the figure, 92% hold time, well, we haven't got any retain. We're 100%. It's just the way they calculate it. And I think that 0.5 to 0.6 is, if you count in, retained as well. These are all the rough and ready figures, aren't they?
Jim, if I may, it's sadly complicated, isn't it? So if I was kind of paying class meetings, I would say we go to more incidents with firefighter than any other firefighting service in the country. And that's quite true. So people get better value for money for the firefighter in Merseyside than they do elsewhere.
Yes?
Thanks, Chair. I'd just like to say well done. Well done from me and well done from the people of St Helens, because I'm here to represent them and I know that they feel a lot safer in their bed reading this report. I'd like to say well done to everybody in the service, to the senior management team, to the firefighters, to the cooks and the cleaners, everybody and the managers. Everybody should be congratulated on this report. Now, I'm not trying to burst anybody's bubble here, but there is, we do have that need to improve. And for many years we've had a problem when we recruit women. We have been recruiting them, but it's getting them to stay within the service. Can I ask that we look at how other authorities deal with maternity and paternity leave and bring a small report back to this authority? Thank you.
Chair, that's absolutely fine. We have some very kind of supportive policies and procedures in place for all the firefighting services. Other organisations who have got similar challenges will have many alternative proposals, alternative policies and alternative procedures. And we're happy to take a look at those and bring them back to the authority for adoption, if that's accepted.
And to include adoption. Adoption.
Yeah, absolutely. And some of our stuff does include adoption needs. Leave, and it also includes individuals who are having support for fertility treatments and so on and so forth. So it covers off all of those bases. We want to be a supportive employer, we want to be an employer of choice, we want people to choose Merseyside Firefighting Service and then probably stay with us through the course of their career. So we're happy, absolutely happy to take a look at the policies that we've got to ensure that we're able to do that.
We've traditionally been very strong on occupational health. And the objective there is to get people, keep people fit, to get people through a period and back to work. Because we've got some great, highly trained, experienced people here, and we want to keep them. And we want to use that experience. And so let's just do a review of where we sit in the fire world with regard to this issue. Bring it back to members, and then we can have a look at the implications thereof. Yes,
Councillor Penn. Yeah, thank you, Chair. I know you made comments at the outset of the meeting, but I think we all need to recognise that overall, this is a fantastic day for Merseyside Fire and Rescue Service, and in particular, the people who live on Merseyside when they see the results of this report. And I, for one, certainly want to applaud the service for enhancing the reputation of Merseyside generally by the outcome of this report. I'm not going to go over like details like the Chief did, but the Inspectorate has given two outstandings to Merseyside as part of this report. And I think we must recognise that in itself is a fantastic achievement, where I think I'm right in saying no other fire authority in the country has achieved two outstandings. So I'd like to congratulate the Chief Fire Officer, his team, particularly the firefighters, fire prevention teams, protection officers, all support services, representative bodies, and basically anybody who's got any involvement at all with the Fire and Rescue Service for the way this report has come out. And I think it needs to be said, Chair, as well, that if anything, the whole situation would have been even better if, as a fire authority, we've been given the proper funding over the last few years from central government. So I think we need to recognise that the fantastic achievements that have been made in a situation where we haven't been given the proper funding that we should have been given from national level. So I think it is true to say that even though, and I recognise what Linda and others have said, there's always room for improvement. You can always do something better. But I think it's heartening for the people of Merseyside when they see this report that's come out, that they know they can feel safe in this community because of the work done by the Fire and Rescue. us.
I know time's pushing on, but I've been on the authority for quite some time. I remember when I first came on, we were under the boot of Her Majesty's Inspectorate, and I think it was a person called Musselwhite, who was the Chief Inspector, and he came to our old headquarters. Peter Dowd was the chairman at the time. And the messages he brought to us, he said, "You are the most expensive fire service in the entire country. That's because you don't have any retained firefighters." Well, 20 minutes later, after Peter Dowd had laid into him, literally laid into him, about the poverty in Merseyside, the statistics that we have, the communities that we serve, the fire risk, the whole rest of it, I think he went away with his tail between his legs. Not long thereafter, well, some years later, the inspectorate was abolished. Then we had the Audit Commission. The Audit Commission came on the first round of inspections, which was mainly related to administration, and we came out as the only authority in the country that had an excellent market. Then some years later, there was the inspection, the Audit Commission again, did an inspection of firefighting, if you like. And there were two authorities in the country that were excellent. We were one of those. So we've been used to having that stamp of approval. And it comes back, really, I think, to the way that we've decided to operate the authority. We've taken brickbats, we've taken hammers, we've had to live with cut and reduced budgets. We've had to deal with the criticism from all governments, actually, from all sorts of people who've inspected us. You know, you could save a lot of money if you went part-time here, if you went day crewing there, if you went, you know, sort of retained here. We've held the line, the members here now and the members previously. And I do believe that this is a blueprint for success. And if only the inspection will do their job, and in December they will have finished that, the next challenge is to pick the best out of the inspections of all authorities around the country and try and exemplify best practice. And, you know, have a budget of money, and that's still to be bid for by the inspectorate. And that's, you know, another thing, isn't it? To try and bring all of the fire authorities up to good, up to excellent, and we can play a role in that. We don't want to be stretched by it. We don't want to be, you know, our eye taken off the ball by trying, we'd love to help other people, but we want to look after the community of Merseyside. This is, as has been said, a great day. We've got to go on from this. We've got to improve incrementally from this, and we have to own these decisions. And the next item is part of the process of trying to make constant innovation and improvement in our fire safety. I want to thank the members of the authority and the politicians of Merseyside who helped and support us as well for all that they've done to get us to where we are today. Thank you very much. Is there anything else on four? If not, we'll move to five. IRMP supplement, it's a consultation on an amendment to the statutory document.
Thanks, Chair. I'll in person for the recommendations. I'll come back to the comments about improvement and improving. First of the report is to request that members consider the outcomes of the public consultation on the our integrated risk management plan supplement 2019-21 and seek approval and publication of the final version. And recommendations are that members consider the content of the consultation process, they note the areas that have been identified and impacted upon by staff, note the proposals within the supplement which have been subject to extensive public consultation, the outcomes of these consultations being attached, approve, importantly, the IRP supplement for 2019-2021 and its implementation, which will provide increased resources to the community of Merseyside for the first time in over 10 years. And approve the IRP supplement 2019-21 for publication in a desired format. I'll then comment on the there is always room for improvement, and there is based on the HMI's the inspectors came back to speak to us after providing some indications of what was contained within the report, some initial feedback. My comment to him was, that's fine, we've already moved on. So I went on to talk about the kind of proposals which are now contained within the IMP supplement, some of which address directly the comments that have now been provided in a written format within the report, with things like cross-border training, things like improving our operational response methodology, and so on and so forth. So we've taken already started to take the learning and apply that across Merseyside. So the actual report itself starts to kind of go about how we've sought to do that. It talks about the consultation process, and comments have been raised or questions have been asked previously about the kind of breadth of the consultation. Paragraph 9, 10, within page 192 and 193, give indications of that. What I would draw people's attention to in particular is the 5 public consultations where we engage with 99 individuals who have a little bit better insight into the work that the Fire Rescue Service has done, because we spend a little bit more deliberative time taking through the proposals in a kind of a structured manner. And some of those individuals have experiences of being part of the consultation process before. So I draw you to page 284 of the consultation document. Page 284 says, and I hope that members are aware of it. Page 284. It's 248, my mistake. The main findings of the consultation with members of the public and deliberative forums say Merseyside planning principles were supported. Again, these are planning principles that have been adopted by the public and endorsed by the authority. There was unanimous support for the new protection, resilience and response proposals. Merseyside planning assumptions were supported. The alternative plan was accepted by all, and all other new IMP proposals were supported. MFRA should consider extending its provision of free smoke alarms to the most deprived areas of Merseyside, but must do so carefully and consider which method it utilises to do so. MFRA, so Merseyside Fire Rescue Authority, offers excellent value for money, but future council tax rises should be carefully considered. There are no equality and diversity impacts. All the proposals are perceived to be positive from those delivered forums. We then move on to the consultation process, which again I draw you to G in relation to paragraph 10. An online questionnaire on the website was available for the public and staff. We had 81 responses. The details of which I draw members to is on page 194, paragraph 16, bullet points, or the first bullet point states 97.4% of respondents, 74 out of 76 valid responses preferred the alternative IMP proposals over the original proposals that were struck in 2016-17 and agreed at that time. What were the proposals that they were considering? Probably the best way to exemplify what it is we are seeking to secure authority approval on is if I draw your attention to this sheet which was left on your desk or your perusal. What it basically asked the public is to consider alternative proposals, which meant, and I'll paraphrase or detail the highest level, a move from 26,000